Go make yourself a drink and I'll be down in 2 shakes of a lamb's tail.
Damn, son, where'd you find this?
They didn't from out of town or whatever, we don't give a fuck. The deal is done, now the cake been baked. They need to come on with the drama, whatever they gonna do.
What's cracking, pimps? What's going on? And welcome to episode 34 of the Mac Daddy Seminar. As always, I am your host, Taylor Dunn. And as you can see, if you're watching the video podcast right now, things are starting to look a little bit different here at the Mac Daddy Seminar. Can you tell the look that we were going for? You get what I'm saying? Oh yeah, it's big time over here. So anyway, let's just cut right to it. Everybody's stuck in quarantine right now due to this whole global coronavirus pandemic, and everybody's looking for ways to keep themselves engaged and, you know, doing more stuff. And me as a comedian, I'm looking for ways that I can create content along with, you know, keeping that creative muscle working. So I went on Facebook and I reached out to a couple of people, and I had this idea to do a Wetumpka High School quarantined reunion. And my idea was to have, you know, everybody that graduated with me in 2012 get all together on a big conference call and us just hash it out and talk it out and whatnot. But after doing it, it really just didn't transfer over well to a podcast setting. Everybody was talking over each other, interrupting each other.
So after 7.
That was like a night shift. I would sleep till like 7 p.m.
It was fun. I really enjoyed it for those of you that were involved, but it just didn't really sound right or look right for a podcast. However, I decided to do something a little bit different where I started reaching out to the same people, but just doing one-on-one interviews. And I'm really happy with the result. So without further ado, my guest today, not only is a good friend of mine, we graduated in 2012 together, absolutely phenomenal guy. We took theater class with each other, and we, you know, took theater class under Jeff Glass at Wetumpka High School. He's not only a talented actor, but a phenomenally talented musician. He tours around as the keyboard and piano player for Anderson East. He's performed alongside Chris Stapleton, Keith Urban. He's performed at the Grammys. He's a Grammy nominated artist, and he went to the same small town high school as me. Without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, my guest today is Philip Towns.
Well, appreciate you thinking about me, man.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, man. I don't even know where to start.
Let's just start with this. So we graduated 2012.
Yep.
What happened after that?
All right. Yeah, graduated in 12. I was set to go to the University of North Alabama, which is in Florence, like Muscle Shoals, Florence area. So, yeah, I went to school there. And I went there, like, you know, with all intentions of, like, going for 4 years and doing the typical college thing and just graduating. And then whatever else happened after that. But I got in, and I think, like, the second semester of my freshman year, I was just kind of like, I think this might be bullshit. And I'm a music guy. I went for, like, you know, music production, entertainment, business, you know, they have all these coded names for things. And so I was going thinking, yeah, I'm going to go and, you know, I'm going to learn how to be a producer and, like, come out and, like, you know, I don't know. Like, nobody really, like, tells you, especially, like, where we're from. Like,
yeah,
there's no, like, you know, nobody tells you, like, no, you shouldn't do that. You should just go this, or you should just, you know, it was like nobody even really knew where UNA was. Like, I had never heard of UNA. I remember we did those, like, theater competitions.
Yeah, that's actually, I was going to bring that up because I was looking you up before we started the call. And when I type in Philip Towns on YouTube, the first video that pops up is one that Chrissy White made from your your scene that you did at Trumbauer that first year.
Bro, which is insane. Which, yeah. like, that scene ended up winning that year, I remember, for that category, which is
I know. And it was so crazy to all of us, because I'm not saying that, you know, we didn't think you were a great actor by any means. You're talented on so many aspects, but you got handed that scene because somebody didn't show up to do it, if I remember correctly. Yeah, somebody didn't get on the bus that morning.
Yeah, somebody just didn't do it. Glass was like, all right, you're up.
I think it was Madison McCardle. She, like, somebody, whoever your partner was, didn't show up that morning. And I remember you were freaking out because you were like, this is my scene that I'm going to do, and I don't know what I'm going to do. And then she just anteed up and she did it, and you ended up winning.
Yes, you're right.
State competition for that.
Madison McCardle, man. Oh my God. That's so wild. Yeah. So that was the first time I had heard of UNA. I didn't know anything about it. And then that next year, it was at UNA again, and I had already applied. And I remember we were like sitting in the awards ceremony or something. And my mom like texted me and said, hey, you got your acceptance letter from UNA while I was at UNA, which is like a weird thing or whatever. So yeah, I went to UNA, and then like maybe like 6, 7, 8 months in my freshman year, I just realized like, I think this is bullshit. Like my program is like, it's not everything they chalked it up to be. Like we just, in long story short, we just didn't have like the proper resources for it to, be a program that they were, you know, selling it to us as. It just wasn't that. Our professors were jaded and, you know, had been in the industry in like the 80s and, you know, hadn't had any real experience with the music industry in years. They were just there tenured collecting a check, you know. So my first mistake was announcing to the world that I was going to quit school my freshman year, and that didn't go too well because everybody was like, what are you doing? You lost your fucking mind. Like, don't do that. So I listened to everybody and I like stayed in school another year and a half. And then finally, like my junior, I think it was the start of my junior year. I can't remember what year it was, but I just remember it was right before Thanksgiving, before coming home for a break. And at this time I was like teaching, I was in school, but I was like teaching piano lessons. I was playing for a church, making money doing that on the weekends. And I was just hustling, just gigging around. Like my friends, we had a couple bands. We'd like, you know, go play around Alabama, do weddings, do events, shit like that. And I just said, man, I'm making enough, Florence is so cheap. I'm making enough money to take care of myself. Fuck it. I'm just going to quit school and I'm save up my money and I'm going to move to Nashville. And that's what I did. I just like one day after class, I just said, fuck it. And I went right to the admissions office and said, what do I need to do to quit school? And they were like, just send us an email. So I went home right after that, sent the email. Hey, I'm done. And I just quit. And and I didn't tell my parents, or I think I called my mom and told her. But like, other than that, that was about it. And I just said, I'm just gonna hustle. I'm just gonna do it. I'm gonna figure it out. And I've been going to Nashville for like 5 or 6 months, just like, you know, trying to meet people, make connections, meet artists, just try to go ahead and, you know, develop something. Actually, there was a situation where, like, before I quit school, I had gone to Nashville and ended up meeting this chick who was on the show The Voice. And like, I had a lot of friends who there's a friend I went to school with and he was on it. So I ended up like becoming cool with a lot of people who were like on The Voice, and like, you know, they didn't make it all the way through, but they were on it and blah blah blah. And so I ended up producing this record for this girl who was on The Voice, and I'm 20 at the time. And I went to my professors and I was like, hey, you know, I scored this record. I'm going to be producing in Nashville. I already booked studio time up there. Everything's already set up. You know, I need a week. I'm going to go up there and be up there for a week. Like, can you excuse my classes, or can you, you know, can you give me credit for, like, this is a whole project. Like, I just hustled this on my own. Like, me and my friends just hustled this. And one of my professors who was like, yeah, totally, go for it. But the other guy who was, like, the head of the department was, like, totally just like, no, I'm sorry, I can't do that. If you miss more than three classes, you know, we'll have to kick you out of the program or whatever some bullshit was. And that was the defining moment for me where I was like, if I'm here, like, this is what you guys are supposed to be teaching me how to do. And I've hustled outside of you and done it, but you're going to penalize me for doing what you should be teaching me how to do. This is bullshit. So that was the turning point for me. So yeah. So then I quit. Yeah. And I was just in Florence, just like hustling, just, you know, doing all the things I said. And maybe like 5 months after that, I was doing studio sessions at the studio called Fame Studios, which is like super historic studio, like Aretha Franklin and like all these like heavy hitters back in the day, like had recorded. The studio was like really famous and kind of like the what would you compare it to? If you've heard of like Motown, it's kind of like Motown of the South.
Motown.
Like the Motown of the South back in the day. Not doing anything now, but it was big back then. But that was the only studio really around. So I was working there. And this artist named Anderson East had come down there to do some recording and like, you know, video footage and stuff. And he was about to go on tour. And so after he had come down there, he was looking for keyboard players, and he called down there and he was like, hey, you know, just as a last ditch effort, do you guys know like anybody, you know, just anybody, please? Cause they had auditioned like 13 or 14 people and nothing was working out. And the studio manager there was like, yeah, there's this kid who like plays pretty good, like super young kid. I should use his number. So it just so happened that, I got connected to Anderson East from working at Fame Studios. And we got connected and I went and auditioned. And next day I got the call, hey, you got the gig. And then I think maybe like a week or two after that, I just went on the road. I was like, I had just turned 21. I was like, maybe like 4 months after I turned 21, 4 or 5 months. And I just went on the road, literally just like, I hadn't moved to Nashville yet either. I just packed a bag, packed a suitcase with some clothes and threw my keyboards. And at this time we were traveling in like a 12 passenger van. He had just got signed and he didn't have any big budgets yet. So they were like, you're going to go get in this van and go travel the country and open up for people and we'll see how it goes. So yeah, I did that. And I went on the road for like 3 or 4 months straight, man, just gone. And, but it was great. Got to go see the world. And, then I finally moved to Nashville at the end of that year and yeah, been here ever since. So then from there, I just kind of, doing all kinds of stuff, man. I still play with Anderson on the road. I'm his music director and I'm co-producing his new record right now. So doing that, outside of that, I'm working on all kinds of stuff, man. I started doing like a side project thing, which is like hip hop and rap. Which is so wild because I was talking to my friend Brady Lunsford, who also lives in Nashville now. We hang out a lot. And it's just funny because like in high school, I was like, you would have never suspected me to rap at all. I was just like the nerdy music theater kid, you know. But yeah, man, I love hip hop. I love rap. I love making beats. And so, I've got a side project that I'm working on. And yeah, I've got music on Spotify. It's under the name Chandler, Chandler. So yeah, there's stuff up there. I released a couple EPs, got some new music coming this year. But yeah, man, I love Nashville, man. It's like a great community of just music people, just people in general. But the community is such a music town.
Yeah.
And you know, it's like just everybody is like some of the best players and writers and producers like in the world. And it's just this community of people, and like, they're just your friends, you know? And it's like what I always wanted, you know? But, yeah, so that's really what's been going on with me, man. I just
I've kept up with you this time. You know, I've been following you on Instagram and things like that over the years. And every time you would post something, I would be like, golly, like I would show it to my wife, Zaina, be like, hey, look at what he's doing now. Like when you did like the Country Music Awards, like I know that was a big thing for you. Like how would you compare? I don't know how big the audience was, but how would you compare like doing those small start out gigs in front of maybe, I'm sure you've, you know, can kind of talk about it more, but whenever you do a small gig, maybe 15, 20 people in a bar or something compared to that, like what would you compare the energy shift in that big of a room to?
Man, I don't even know how to compare it, to be honest with you. It's like, honestly, in my mind, I try to, I just try to not to make it a big deal. I just try to downplay it on purpose. I just try to psych myself out, you know, because if you start thinking about, you know, I think I've done 2 CMA awards with Chris Stapleton. I've done an ACM award with Keith Urban. I did that last year, which was insane and awesome in Vegas. Yeah, it's just like, what's funny is the comparison in, you know, in people and numbers is like, can be so daunting that like, you know, it can psych you out of like doing your job. So I try to like just say, hey, it's another gig. But what's crazy is that like the small gigs are what prepare you for the big stages. You know, that sounds like super cliche, but it's so true. You know?
I agree,
so,
like, 100%.
I grew up playing in my parents' tiny little storefront church, you know, like 15, 20 people every Sunday. It's like not big, whatever. But that's where I like cut my teeth, so to speak. You know, that's where I was figuring out how to, you know, play all this stuff and how to, you know, if somebody's singing, how to not play over them or how to play with a band, you know, stuff like that. That's where I learned all that stuff. And then you cut to 5 years later and you're on the stage in front of however many thousand people. It's the same thing, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, man, I'm really appreciative of even stuff like being in theater class and the musical theater stuff that we did in high school. Like, you don't really think about it then, but like even all that stuff, you know, is preparation for every little bit, man. Every little bit goes into the craft. So,
oh yeah, I agree. As a, you know, since I moved out here, I've had so many more opportunities to do stand up. That was really why I picked these orders, because I knew that I would be able to develop more as a stand up. And since I got here, I just hit the ground running. I took a class when I got here, even though I'd been doing it for years. I took a class just to really network and meet people. And, you know, I've been able to, the biggest crowd that I've done, I did in February. I was part of a talent show here on Coronado, the island that I live on. And it was all clean comedy. It was meant for, you know, a family audience, but it was 850 people. And it was a very short set. Wasn't the best I've ever done, but like you said, the brick by brick, those small little things in the beginning, doing a monologue for a theater class or doing an open mic at 18 years old for 10 people, those things really build over the years. And it's wild whenever you get out in front of that many people.
Yeah, man, it really is. So I'm grateful for all the humble beginnings, man. Like, it's wild, you know, especially coming from where we come from, you know, Utumka. It's like, again, nobody like, it's such a small town that I think that just the surroundings, you know, just the mentality really is like, you know, you're not really expected to really kind of do big things, so to speak. Right. You know what I mean? Like,
I agree, 100%.
Just kind of, you know, you're just kind of expected, like, hey, you may move to you know, a decently sized city and start a family and get a nice job and settle down. And that's cool. Like, and that's totally fine. And there's nothing wrong with that by any means. But, you know, when you're like kind of how we are, ambitious and creative, and you want to do something with it, you know, you kind of have to just kind of figure it out and kind of find your own way. So yeah, man, I'm really grateful though from all those little things, man, for all those people like Glass who would piss us off, but pushed us in a lot of ways too, you know?
Yeah. I still talk to him. I had a showcase that I did back in November, and I had it filmed, and he was one of the first people I sent it to. And I was like, hey, how do you feel about this? Just to get his critique on it.
Yeah.
And he was like, I really appreciate you showing this to me. Years later, you still come to me for some type of advice. And I was like, well, you were one of the first people to tell me that, you know, you believed in me, that you thought,
right,
okay, yeah, you can say somebody's funny, but to actually, you know, like, forgive me if you think I'm wrong, but as a musician, you know, you have a talent for playing the piano that everybody can see right off the bat. Like, if sure. you sit down and you just go absolutely bonkers on the piano, they know watching that, okay, that has taken years to master that craft. Whereas if you're just standing in front of a group of people and you crack a couple of jokes or you say something funny, they might not think, oh, he can be a stand-up comedian, because the performance aspect of it is a whole lot different than just talking around a lot of people that you feel comfortable in front of.
Totally. Totally.
So, you know, he was one of those people that I felt like I could confide in. You know, I had a pretty rough bunch of friends when I was in high school. I got involved in some things I probably shouldn't have. And he always really kept me grounded. I would always, you know, try and talk to him and let him know, like, hey, I do take this seriously. And, you know, even to this day, I still reach out to him and, you know, ask him how he's doing and stuff like that. So, like you said, I'm thankful for the humble beginnings. It really does help in the long run.
It does, man. Yeah, I keep in touch with him too. Usually when I'm home for the holidays, we stay in touch. But yeah, man. No, back to your point, man. I think comedy, I have so much respect for comedy, man. Like, comedians, I think it's one of the highest art forms you could do. It really is, because it's so singular. Like, with music, like, it's, you know, especially a lot of times, like, you may have one singer or one artist, but they're backed by a band, or like you said, there's an instrument, there's an additional thing. With comedy, it's just you. It's just you up there with the mic. And like, if you don't deliver, if it doesn't hit, if it doesn't whatever, like, that's it. All you got, you know. I just think it's like a case study in psychology too, you know, like, learning how, like, you can say something, A and it not hit. You can say something B and it be the same thing you said in A, but you said it differently.
Yeah,
and it hits.
It's almost, you know, just like a musical, like, it's almost like a symphony. Like, I can say something a certain way and put a little bit different of a fringe on the way I say it and get a bigger reaction, and it'll be the same thing I said the night before, and it's just dead silent.
Exactly.
So when you start breaking down the sciences of it, it's really kind of amazing. Like, when I've been doing it for a while, and I wouldn't any way compare what I've done with stand-up compared to what you've done as a musician. I mean, I think it's two different things, but I'm still at the base level learning. Like, I still do open mic. I still, you know, do small rooms, and, you know, sometimes I get lucky and I get to do a bigger room or something like that. I still, you know, I have a full-time job, but I'm using that job to pay for my dream, my creative aspect, which is stand-up.
Right.
And it allows me to travel around, get new perspectives, meet new people. That was the main thing that got me into going into the military was, you know, I wanted to get out of Alabama. I wanted to broaden my horizons, see more things, meet more people. And for the most part, I've been able to do that. You know, while I was in Gulfport, Mississippi, I went to New Orleans a lot. I did a lot of stand-up there. I did small little bars around Gulfport and things of that such. But just going on deployments. Like I went to a comedy show one time in Guam.
Oh, wild.
Yeah. It was, but that was the thing. I like you said, you just kind of got to find your own way to like finagle your way into things. And sometimes you'll surprise yourself. Like, how did I end up here? You know?
Oh man. What, like what the military was for you, touring was for me, because to be really honest with you, I always wanted to be in the studio. Like, I remember being like, after I learned how to play keys, I realized like what being a producer was. And I was like, man, that's what I want to do. Cause I love being creative. You know, I love making things. I love being in the studio. I love vibing with artists. And after I quit school, I remember people asking me like, what are you going to do? Like, what's your plan? I just remember telling people like, the last thing I want to do is tour. Like, I don't want to tour. I want to just want to move to Nashville and like get settled and figure out how to make records. And again, nobody really tells you that, like, if that's your goal, you should probably go tour, because you're going to meet artists, you're going to meet musicians, you're going to meet, you know what I mean? Like, nobody tells you the game of it.
The networking aspect. Yeah,
exactly. You're going to meet labels. You're going to meet, you know, all these things. And, yeah, and that's exactly what the military was for you. Touring was for me. So I went on the road. I took the gig because, well, I didn't have any other job, you know? So I was like, well, I'm going to take this and do it. And same thing with you. Like, I need to get out of Alabama. I want to, you know, it's an opportunity. And yeah, man, it literally took me around the world, man. Like, you know, I can't tell you how many times I've been to Europe. You know, I went to Australia last year. Just like literally have traveled the world, you know.
What's your favorite place that you've been?
Favorite place, Stockholm, Sweden. Mm. I love Sweden, man. I don't know what it is about. It's very, very clean city. Every Swedish person is the most beautiful person you've ever seen in your life. Guy.
Oh yeah, I can imagine.
The guys are just like, look like they've been chiseled from the gods or some shit. Like,
yeah,
crazy. And the women are beautiful, and the food's amazing. It's really expensive to live there, but if I ever get to the point where I can really afford to live there, I'll move to Stockholm, Sweden in a heartbeat, man. Love it.
I felt the same way when I was in Spain. I was in Spain for 6 months, my first deployment, and I had the time of my life while I was over there. I mean, I was married, of course, so I couldn't, you know, get on women and stuff. But even like walking into McDonald's, you would see people.
Yeah.
The most beautiful people you've ever seen in your life.
Working
at McDonald's.
Working at the McDonald's. Yeah.
Like, I remember I was ordering a cheeseburger, and just the guy who was waiting on me, I was like, are you you've got to be a model or something.
Or something. Right.
And he's like, exactly. No, I just work here. I go to the university, you know,
Yeah. It's not a low class, like, you know, job or anything there. Yeah. It's like the way their societies are set up, man. It's just, you know, there's, I love being American. I love, you know, having all the freedoms and rights that we do. But when you get to travel, it just opens up your mind, man. And like one of my favorite quotes is by Mark Twain, and it's, travel is the best cure for ignorance. And that's like stuck with me like ever since I've heard that phrase, because it is, because you don't know what you don't know, you know. Like,
God, you just blew me away with that, man.
Man, it's really changed my perspective, man. Like, because yeah. You don't, you know, growing up we talk Alabama, like, you know, from everything, you know. I'm, you know, I've been in Sweden, and like there's been people who've like, you know, promoters of our shows who've like had us over at their houses and cooked us dinners, and, you know, like these people, and they have totally, you know, different lives and beliefs and, you know, all this kind of stuff. I remember that like really like rocking my world, like when it came to things as far as like religion and stuff like that, you know, because I grew up in the South, and it's very, my parents are pastors, and it's very, you know, like this is right, this is wrong, whatever. You go across the world and like you sit and have a conversation with these people, and in Sweden they're a-religious. Like they're most of them are atheists. They don't grow up with any kind of concept of religion. you know.
Yeah.
But they've got me in their home, and they're feeding me, and they're showing me hospitality and all this love, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then it makes you're like, whoa, like, so how do you reconcile that? You know, like, yeah. how do you say they're going to go to a bad place and I'm going to go to a good place when they've been more loving to me than some people that I grew up with, you know?
Yeah. I agree with you there. Like, when I was in Spain, just going like to some of the cathedrals that were over there, because they're very heavy Catholic based there, and just going to some of the cathedrals and walking through them, it was like, you just look, it's just a literal architectural marvel, just staring at the ceilings and stuff like that, and going down into like the crypts and stuff like that, and how the roofs of it were built in such a way to where you can stand in the middle of the room and it makes an echo, where if you stand on the other side of the room, it doesn't, like, stuff like that. And, you know, it's thousands of years old, and it was amazing. But I know what you mean, though. Like, I was raised as a Jehovah's Witness, which a lot of people.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. A lot of people don't realize that. Yeah. I was a Jehovah's Witness up until I was about 15 years old. So I didn't celebrate any birthdays, any real major holidays, no Christmas or anything like that. And we ended up getting out of the religion right as I was entering high school. So I went from, you know, not being able to hang out with these people because they were considered worldly people. They were, you know, going to the church and they didn't believe what we believed, to, you know, now I had all these friends. So it was like, I was so sheltered up until I got to my freshman year of high school. And then it was just like wide open. I wanted to hang out with everybody. And, you know, I had a blast. I loved it. But it was still those 4 years. I was like, I want to, you know, go and see what else is out there.
Totally.
So I think that upbringing kind of made me into who I am now, to where, you know, now I want to go see more things. Like, that's my number one thing that I want to do. Like, I tell my wife, like, hey, I'm not worried about having a super nice car or living in a mansion or anything. I want to travel. I want to go see this. I want to go see that. And for the most part, I've gone and seen a lot of stuff that I've wanted to. I still want to go explore Europe a little bit more. I want to do Paris if I can.
Yeah. What's on the list? What's on the top of the list?
For me, I've always wanted to go to the Vatican. I want to go to Italy real bad and go see the Vatican and things like that. I've always wanted to go to Paris. I love French food.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I don't know why, but my favorite restaurant in the world right now is a restaurant, believe it or not, in Disney World.
No way.
It's in Epcot. Yeah. If you go to Epcot in Disney World, there's in the French section, there's a restaurant called Chef de France. And the first time I ever ate there, it was on my honeymoon with my wife. She had been there 4 or 5 times growing up, and I'd never been before. And we went to that French restaurant, and I sat down, and I shit you not, the lobster bisque they brought to the table, and I took a bite of it, I almost busted out crying. And I told the waiter, who was French, that's what's so cool about it. I don't know if you've ever been, but, you know, when you walk around Epcot, it's like a world showcase. So every section is, you know, different people from that area of the world. So when you go to France, everybody that works there is from France. And our waiter comes up to the table and he's like, is everything all right, sir? I'm like, I'm gonna be honest with you, this is the best thing I've ever tasted. And he was just so taken back by it. He was like, thank you, sir. Like, I don't know if he made it himself or what, but he was just like, thank you so much. And oh, it was fantastic. So I really want to go over to France and see if they can outdo what they're doing here in Disney
World. Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure. I've been to Paris once, but it was such a business thing. It was like an in and out, you know, thing that I didn't really get to experience the city. And that's the only thing about touring that kind of sucks is people have this idea that, like, oh, you're like traveling the world and like you're getting to see all these places, and you do to an extent, but it's only like, you know, you're playing a venue. You're there for a purpose. You're not there on vacation, you know? So like you pull up and like, you know, you wake up on a tour bus and you walk outside and it's just, you know, you really only know this block area, you know, like your schedule is, you know, wake up, you got to set your stuff up, around middle of the day, around lunchtime, you set all your equipment up. And then after that, you get about 2 or 3 hour break while the crew, like, you know, sets everything up and connects all the stuff and makes sure the sound's working. You can go off and get lunch or do whatever you want to do. Then you got to do sound check. Then you get another 2 to 3 hour break. Then you do dinner, and then you get another like 2 hour break to get ready for the show. And that's your day every day on loop, you know, however long you're out on tour, however many weeks you're out on tour. So you don't have time to like, you know, go here, go there, do this, see that, unless you have an off day, you know, in that same city, then you can go explore. But yeah, so that's the only thing that kind of sucks about touring. But, you know, it's cool. But yeah, touring, like traveling the world, has made me such a foodie, man. Like,
oh yeah,
I didn't know all of these like cuisines and like, you know, like, and Nashville's becoming a big city, and it's got a lot of more variety than Alabama.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
You know, going like living in California, you know, or like going to places in like LA or New York. You go to New York or LA for the first time, and I just remember like all this, you know, just all this kind of food that you just don't have in Alabama. Korean food, you know, like never heard of Korean food growing up, you know, like all this crazy stuff, Korean food and Thai food. My favorite foods are all Asian cuisines now. Any Asian cuisine, Korean food, Thai food. I'm trying to think of what else, like having real Mexican food changed my life.
Oh yeah.
I remember going to California, having real Arizona and California, having authentic Mexican food. And I was like, oh my God.
Yeah. I'm literally like, I could get in the car right now and start driving and I will be in Mexico in 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So totally. Out here, if I just go a little ways down the road past Imperial Beach over to San Isidro, some places down there, like we went to a place right before all this stuff started with this quarantine, and I forget the name of it, but we went in there and it was like a seafood-based Mexican restaurant.
Yeah.
And they had a mariachi band in there playing, walking around. And yeah. Everybody in there spoke Spanish.
Yep. And that's how you know.
Oh, it was unbelievable.
Yeah.
And my buddy, his wife, she can speak fluent Spanish, and she was ordering everything for everybody at the table in Spanish. And I mean, it was phenomenal. So you're right about that. Mexican food in California is
unparalleled, man. Rule of thumb for any kind of like ethnic cuisine: if you see other people of that ethnicity in their eating, you're good.
Oh yeah.
If they don't speak English, it's going to be amazing. Oh yeah.
Yep. That's great. Yeah.
For any kind of food, like if they don't speak English, go in there.
Yeah. As far as LA goes, how you mentioned the food in LA, we've been trying to get up there and actually do like an exploring day. Because every time I've been to LA, which is like 5 times now, I've literally gone to one spot, and that's the Sunset Strip.
Oh yeah, because
that's where the Comedy Store, the Laugh Factory. Right. You know, all of that stuff is. And every time I go, I'm literally on like maybe 500 feet of road. And then we just get in the car and come right back whenever it's late.
Right. Like touring.
But yeah, I don't know if you've ever been, but if you ever get an opportunity, you said you're a fan of comedy. If you ever have an opportunity when you're in LA, go to the Comedy Store.
Bro, I was about to say that I'm so jealous of the comedy scene in LA, man. I love going to see live comedy. We've got one place in Nashville, Zany's.
Oh yeah. And
we get popular acts, but it's nothing like, the scene is nothing like how it is in LA. Yeah, man. I'm so jealous.
Yeah, man. If you ever swing through this way, I'm telling you, like, I follow everything on social media, so I know, like, who is coming when. And I've yet to go see Dave Chappelle. He's the main one that I want to go see there.
Bro. Like,
he's the GOAT to me. He's the one.
Oh, yeah.
He's,
yeah, absolutely.
And I almost went once to go see him, but his ticket sold out in 20 seconds as soon as they announced it. Because they can't bill him like everybody else. Like, when they put his – if they put Dave Chappelle will be at the Comedy Store tonight, there'll be a riot in the street.
Yeah.
So they have to bill it as, oh, we have a secret headliner coming to the Belly Room, which only seats 60 people. Tickets will be $100. This, you know, this person is a smoker, and you're not allowed to bring your phone. So with that much information, I was like, it's Dave. So I called my buddy, and I was like, hey, you need to clear your schedule tonight because I'm about to buy these tickets. We're going to go to L.A., and we're going to watch Dave Chappelle. And I sat there, refresh, sold out.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I come to find out later that Paul Rudd, John Mayer, and Leonardo DiCaprio were all in the audience.
Bro, are you fucking kidding me?
I'm not. It was 60 people in the room. If you've watched his special, it's on Netflix. It's The Bird Revelation.
Yeah.
He filmed that special in that room.
That's the one. Gotcha.
And it only seats about 60 people. But, you know, I haven't been lucky enough to see him. I got to go see Joe Rogan back in September.
I love Joe Rogan, yeah.
Which that was really cool. I met Chris D'Elia the same night.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, that's what's so cool about that place, man. Like, when you walk around in the hallway, they're just in there working.
They're there. Yeah,
so exactly. When you walk around, you're like, you know, that's Chris D'Elia, or, you know, that's Steve Byrne or Joey Diaz or all these people that, you know, I listen to their podcast pretty much daily. That's where they go work out during the week. So
yeah, exactly. And that's the beauty of, you know, I think that's similar in what we both do. Is if you're the only thing that I heard that kind of stuck with me in college was one of my professors said, you have to be present to win. And I didn't really understand that until now. But it's true. It's like whatever you want to do, you need to be there. You need to be around, you know, like comedy, for instance. LA is the same. Like you said, you just walk in the room and it's like all the greats, all your idols, and they're just there working shit out. You never know what's going to happen. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Same with me. It's like just being around and being, you know, in the studio, and you know, you don't think that whoever is about to come in and it's like, oh yeah, I'm best friends with so-and-so. And it's like your favorite artist, or it's like, you know, you were just listening to them this morning, or it's like, hey, come hang. We're going to go have drinks. My friend so-and-so, you know, and it's like the number one songwriter in the country. And you know what I mean? You're just like chilling or what, you know, because it's like you're just connected and you're just around or you're present, you know, yep. And you end up writing a song with them. You end up playing on the record. You end up whatever. That to me is more, freaks me out more than like the big things, you know, because like you kind of, you know, like you want the big things. So you kind of have this expectation and you put this thing into it. It's the things that I don't think about. You know, it's like, you know, all those like albums that I looked on the back of the record covers and it was like the musicians that I looked up to played on. And like, now I'm in the studio with it. It's stuff like that, you know, that like, yeah, I wasn't even, the, you know, or like artists you weren't expecting to work with, you know, and it's like, oh shit. Like I was actually a fan of them. And like, now like I'm playing on their record and like, you know, we're boys and like, we keep in touch and you know, like shit like that. That's the shit that makes me go, damn, this shit feels like a dream, you know?
Yeah, I felt the same way. I went and me and my wife went to go see Donnell Rawlings at the Comedy Store here in Hoya.
He is on another level,
bro. Oh, he is, man. And watching him live is, because the Comedy Store here in La Jolla, there's only two comedy stores. There's the main one in LA and there's the La Jolla Comedy Store here in San Diego. And that's pretty much the big club in town. You know, that's where all the major acts go. And, you know, some of the other places get some bigger name acts too. Like they just had Dave Attell downtown. And I missed that one. But whenever they said Donnell Rawlings was coming and I want to take my wife on a date night, I got to find somebody that I think that she will enjoy.
Right.
So I'm exactly. like, let's go see him. And it was just so surreal because we sat right in the front row and he started messing with me. He asked me if I was a cop because of my hair. I was like, no. He's like, oh, you're in the military, ain't you? And I was like, yeah. And he was like, what branch? He was like, Navy. And he was like, anybody in a real branch in here? And then I was like, what, you in the Air Force? Like, and so we kind of had that back and forth. But just to get to talk to him after the show and yeah. like thinking about how, man, I remember being 10 years old at my dad's house watching Comedy Central late at night so that I could watch the Chappelle show and see
right.
as Ashy Larry and him
right.
as much as involvement he had in the Chappelle show. Like, golly, I'm actually getting to meet this guy. And we had a conversation. So it was just surreal.
Yeah, man, it really is. It really is, man. And it's just from like, just taking a leap, man, you know, like just literally taking a leap of faith, like, you know, believing in yourself enough to be like, you know, I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's enough belief or it's just enough, fuck it, you know, just be like, I don't have anything else to lose, you know, fuck it. I'm just gonna do it, you know. And I feel like, you know, if more people encouraged younger people to do that, I think we would have like a, I don't know. I just think people would be more happy and you know, at least you tried.
Yeah, you know, absolutely. Like, I was actually about you know? To, that was one of the questions that I had written down. Like, in your creative process, do you ever catch yourself at times like kind of beating yourself up almost to the sense of like, I'm not doing anything? Like, do you almost get like writer's block, and does it sometimes cause you to get like in a way depressed? Cause I know it hits me sometimes where I'm like, I'm not coming up with any jokes. Like right now we're in quarantine. This is like a perfect time to like sit here and just stockpile material.
Totally.
And I've only come up with so much since I've kind of been in lockdown. You know, do you have spaces of time where you're like, okay, I have to finish this song today? Or is it just like, do you just create whenever the feeling hits?
No, man, I'm so hard on myself, man, and it's a blessing and a curse. But to be quite honest with you, man, literally this morning, like I was laying in bed, like I just had one of those days where I'm just like, I had said, I always like try to set goals for myself every day of like, if I'm home, shit I need to get done, you know. And yeah, it was just like, I just wasn't feeling it this morning. It was just like, there's some days I think I'm trash, you know, like there's some days that like, for me, the thing is like, I'll make something and in the moment, like, I feel like it's amazing. Like, I feel like it's great, whatever. And the next morning, I always like go back and make sure I'm not crazy. So I always like go back, wake up, and like, let me play this again and see if this is any good. And half the time I'm like, yeah, I fucks with this. And then half the time I'm like, ah, nah, not really, you know, whatever. And for me, I'm learning to distance my emotion from the outcome of whatever it is, you know. And it's hard because we're artists. So we put our emotions and our, you know, we put all of ourselves into what we make. Uh-oh.
You're good. Right. I got you now.
Right. Yeah, I need to plug up my phone so it doesn't die. But yeah, you know, we put everything into what we do, and when the product of something that you make is not up to your expectation, then you start feeling like you're trash, and that, you know, you feel like it's a reflection of who you are. Well, it's not true. It has nothing to do with who you are as a person. It's just not, you know, you're playing the comparison game within your own mind, and that's where you get fucked up. Because, you know, we're comparing what we do at the stage that we are in our career to the Donnell Rawlings and to the Dave Chappelle's. They've been doing this for 20, 25 something years, you know, and so that's where our level of taste is. But sometimes some of the things we do, we don't think it meets up to that, you know. And I could go play the song that I made for somebody on the street and they'd be like, bro, this shit is fire, you know, but I'm in my own head about it.
Yep.
You know? And
yep,
so
I'm the same way with, with jokes. And like when I'll sit down and I'll write something, I'm like, ah, this is whatever. And you know, I freak myself out before a performance because I want it to go so well and I don't want to miss a beat whenever I'm doing it. So I'll memorize it just like a monologue. This is how I did everything before I moved out here. Like anytime I had, even if it was just an open mic in front of 10 people, I would memorize the entire set word for word. And it got to where it sounded almost robotic. So when I moved out here and I took this class, you know, a lot of people in the class, it was a beginner's class because that was the only thing available. And they were like, you've done this before, you know how to perform in front of a group. You know, why are you taking this class? And I was like, well, I want to know how you feel about just kind of going off book. And they kind of coached me into getting to where now I'll go and do an open mic and I'll record myself, but I won't have anything prepared. I'll just go and talk about whatever I'm feeling, or I might have just like a few notes jotted down, and then just kind of seeing that will spring load how I feel about it into me saying it to the mic, and it will get a bigger reaction than, you know, something I might have written down and worked on for weeks and months beforehand.
Totally. Yeah.
Like I did it just as kind of like a, way to stunt on my buddy. He came with me one night and we were in the car and he was like, you should just go up there and just start talking. And I was like, you really want me to? And he was like, yeah. And I'd only actually done it that way maybe three times before it. And I went up there and I talked about everything me and him talked about in the car.
Yeah.
On the way up there, just to show him like, there's no way I could have written about this. We just talked about it a few minutes ago.
Right.
And, you know, he was like, that's what you need to do every single time. Do you,
yeah,
is there ever a time where you're on stage? Like, I know a lot of your songs are pre-written like that, but do you ever have like a time for you can just do like a solo on the piano to where you can just let loose?
Yeah, man, totally. It's like a half and half thing, you know, because it's like, like you said, you preconceive, you know, these ideas that you put into a song. But I never play the same thing the same way, you know. And to keep things really simple, it's just like, however I'm feeling in the moment, you know, that's how it, you know, I express through my fingers. So I may not, you know, from a musical standpoint, I may not voice a chord the exact same way, just like you may, you know, you may flip a joke or you may say something with a different inflection or, you know, it's kind of like that. But yeah, or there may be times where, you know, like when I play with Anderson, it's like, there's a section in the set where, before the last song of the set, I kind of get this piano solo. It's different every night, you know, cause I'm feeling a different way. Sometimes it's super classical. Sometimes it's like, just whatever, you know, like whatever, literally whatever I'm feeling in the moment, I just play and just go off the cuff and improvise. And that kind of goes back to like just growing up in church and just kind of playing, you know, there's no, especially in like black gospel churches, there's not a lot of structure. It's really just kind of like get up there and just do whatever, you know, like there would be times like there would be, you know, when I was really young and learning how to play, there would be no keyboard player. And my parents would just be like, just push me and be like, get up there. Now I have no idea what the song was. I wouldn't know what key they were singing in. They would just be like, if there is a keyboard, there's a piano, keyboard, organ, and nobody was playing it, your ass is getting up there and you playing and you're gonna figure it out. And that's the best way to do it, man. That's the best, because you learn and you grow. And you know, I think now I'm having to learn how to not overthink, you know, because I can get so analytical, you know, in my process, and you start overthinking yourself out of the cool shit. The cool shit came from, like you said, you just get up there and you just kind of like wing it and talk about whatever, you know, and it's like, you know, not taking yourself too seriously, you know, and like feeling like something has to be, you know, I can be a perfectionist in that way. So, man, it's all a learning curve. It's the whole thing is a learning curve, constantly trying to just figure it out, you know?
Yeah, man. Do you like practice? I'm sure you do, but like, what do you have, like a set regimen? Like, okay, I'm going to sit and play the piano for an hour straight today.
So not with keys anymore. I spent my teenage years practicing, really. Like, I started playing at 12, and yeah, I just kind of like literally like just fell in love with playing the piano, just playing music and playing the piano. So I spent like all that time practicing, and because I was playing gospel music, it's so musically intricate that I was learning things. I didn't know it, but I was learning very complicated musical ideas and structures and arrangements at a very young age. So I kind of got ahead of the curve when it came to that. So I don't practice keys anymore, because I kind of realized at a point that like, I don't really need to get better in order to, like, pop music and, you know, everything, pretty much everything that's not gospel music is very simple musically. And I've come to appreciate that simplicity. And so because I've like got all of this like musical knowledge from gospel music, I was like, I don't really need to like get better in order to do what I want to do. But as far as production goes, I'm always practicing in the sense of like, I'm always trying to get better. So I'm always making beats. I'm always like, yeah, that's where my practice time goes now. It's just trying to figure out how to be the best producer I can be. So that's really where the practice time comes in. And honestly, learning psychology too has been a big thing when it comes to that. Like, I know we were talking about that in the comedy field, but with music too, it's like, I think social media is such an interesting, I don't know, experiment.
Yeah.
And just seeing like what people respond to, and especially like when it comes to my field of like music and stuff, it's so interesting to me to just see like how people react to certain things. And like, it's such a game now to figure out like, and I know you probably understand this too, but to figure out how to present your art to the world through social media. Like, that to me is like a whole like psychological experiment, and it's really interesting to me. So outside of like the music and practicing like production and learning how to be a good producer, I'm always like intrigued when I'm just on social media and just scrolling and looking and just seeing like how people respond. And that's something I like. I don't regret anything. I don't regret my path, but if I knew what I knew back when I was in college, I would have went for psychology. So I feel like if you can understand people and understand how people work, anything is possible. Insert whatever, you know, like, yep. Anything you can, you know, you learn how to communicate whatever ideas you want to communicate to people. So that's been the most interesting thing, I think, for me in this whole time. It's just learning how to communicate what I want to communicate to people, whether that's through song or through presenting an idea, or just saying like, hey, you know, like, here's a Zaddy shirt. You know what I mean? Like that.
Which I appreciate, by the way. You sent me one, and I'll wear it and go do open mic or whatnot. And I always have people say like, hey, I like your shirt.
Oh, that's cool.
And I always give you a shout out. Like, yeah, this is my boy Philip Towns. Like, he's working on music, and you know, this is his brand. And I'll let him know. So,
thanks, man. I appreciate that. What's your process? I'm curious what your process is with comedy. How do you work out the joke?
So, the way I started doing it when I very first, like off the jump, like, you know, I tried out everything when I was in high school, whenever we were in that theater class. I originally wanted to be an actor. I always thought about being in big blockbuster movies and things like that. That's what I wanted to do. But even from like a very, very young age, my mom would always be like, he wants to be the next Jim Carrey. That's what he wants to do. Yeah. And I always like wanted to do something. It sounds kind of almost, I'm not using the right word, but it sounds like something where you, it's not a humble thing, but I always wanted to be kind of the center of attention. So when I was in high school and I took theater, I wanted to be an actor, but I never could find a scene that I liked. So I was like, well, I'll just write one, because I always liked writing. Any type of English assignment that allowed me to write something out, I always enjoyed it. So I was like, well, I'll just write my own scene. And when I turned that in to Glass, he was just like, you wrote this? And I was like, yeah. And he was, you know, from the jump, he was very, very, you know, helpful with everything. And he would work with me on it and be like, I think you should change this. So around that time is when I was like, maybe I should try stand-up comedy. So I did the same around that time is when I was like, okay, maybe I'll try and be a comedian. So I did it my junior year, and then I did it again my senior year. And by that time, I was like, okay, this is what I want to do with my life. So as soon as I graduated, I went online and I looked up comedy clubs in Alabama. And there's one, the Stardome Comedy Club in Birmingham. And I went up there.
Wow.
I went up there my very first time. I signed up for open mic. It was all competition-based at the time. And you know, I'm so nervous because everybody else that's there is like in their 30s or 40 years old. And here I am, you know, 18-year-old kid, you know, long hair, weighed about a buck 15. And I got my mom and my girlfriend, who's now my wife, with me.
Right.
And, you know, I'm so nervous and I'm going back and forth to the bathroom and I'm in the hallway looking up at the ticket booth, and I see my dad, who I haven't seen in like 10 years.
Oh my God, you're kidding me.
I guess he had saw I'd put it out on Facebook that, you know, I'm doing stand up here, and he lived in Birmingham with his new wife.
Bro.
So what? I was psyched out, you know, but I'm backstage and I'm like, okay, you know, I'm here. This is what I want to do. I need to go out here and show out. I didn't let anybody hear my material, anything beforehand. I wanted it to be a show for them. I bought my mom her ticket. I bought my girlfriend her ticket. And I went out there and I just let loose for 5 minutes. And I ended up winning. I ended up winning first place my very first time on stage, beat out 15 other people. And doing that got me a show on the main stage a couple of months later. And that was in front of, at that time, that was the biggest crowd I had ever done. So from the first time that I did stand up to the time that I did it on a stage, on the main stage there at the Stardome, which seats about 500 people, I'd only done stand up two other times. So my process was always just, okay, what do I think is funny? And then I'd jot something down, and then I would get to a point to where I'd be like, okay, this makes sense. This is what I'm going to do. And I would just memorize it. And then I would say it into a tape recorder and I would listen to that.
Right.
So by the time I actually got up on stage to do it, it was like,
you knew what
it was like. I was coming up with it on the spot.
Right. Right.
And I took about a 4-year break after that last show. I only did stand up like 4 or 5 times from the very first time that I started in June of 2012 to November of 2012. I took like a 4-year break where I was, you know, I was always planning on doing it, but I just lacked the motivation. I was working, or, you know, I was dabbling in drugs. I'm not afraid to admit it. And sure. I wanted to party and I wanted to, you know, live this fun life. And I never really sat down and put the work in like I used to. And then, you know, I ended up joining the military and it was a couple of months after my first deployment, which now I'm married and, you know, I have a wife and I've got a kid on the way, and somebody put up a video of that performance. And I was like, you know what happened to that? Why didn't I try to do that anymore? And then I just kind of spring loaded me back into it. I started writing again and pretty much the same process. I know this is a very long way of answering your question, but
no, I love it, man. I love hearing the story.
But I started writing again. I started, you know, watching a lot more stand up and, you know, I feel like since then I really started trying to make, you know, stockpile material. And even though, you know, doing open mic in the South is hard because there's not a lot of opportunities to do it.
Right.
So, you know, I would go to New Orleans and do it sometimes, or I would even go back to Alabama. I'd go back to that same club and do it there. And, you know, it wasn't until just recently when I moved out here, now I really have a place to do stand up every night of the week. And it'll be in a legitimate club. Like here you call for spots, you can call, you know, the Comedy Palace on Monday and Tuesdays and do open mic. And you can even set up a time for when they can expect you to come in.
Right.
You got the American Comedy Company on Tuesday nights. You got the Comedy Store on Wednesday night. Like there's so much that you can set yourself up for. Like you were talking about how it's all about being present and right. being there. And now I rehearse. That's the one difference between being a musician and being a comedian, or not the one difference, but I'd say the biggest difference is when you want to practice your craft, you can do that from the confines of your own home.
Totally.
When I want to practice, I have to get up in front of people and do it live.
That sounds so nerve-wracking. Like
it is.
Do you get used to it? You just get used to it, or is it like, you know, it's a different crowd every time. So how do you gauge what you think is a good joke or what's going to work when, you know, your focus group, so to speak, is different every time?
So I try to go and watch a lot, even if I'm not going to go up on stage. Like if I call in the Comedy Store, it's a lot of places, it's a raffle system. So you call them between 12 and 4 and they put your name in a bucket. And then at 4 o'clock, you call them and you see if you got picked for open mic. And if you did, cool, whatever. But if I don't, I still try and make an effort to get up there and just watch. So that way I can kind of gauge, okay, like La Jolla is super nice houses. They have a Lamborghini dealership up there. You know, it's very, very, you know, a lot of big money up towards that area. So, you know, I know there's going to be people up there who are pretty wealthy. You have the American Comedy Company, which is right there in downtown. It's a lot of bars and things like that. So you might be dealing with a crowd that's had a little bit more to drink. Comedy Palace is more towards like the suburbs of San Diego. So, you know, it might be a little bit smaller crowd, but the people up there are a lot nicer. They're a lot more receptive to amateur comedians.
Right, right.
So, totally. It's all different depending on where you are. And I guess, I don't know, it's like you talk about it with some people, but they don't understand. So that was one of the reasons I reached out to you, because I know you would understand, you know, a little bit about being around crowds and
totally
that sort of thing. But but yeah, as far as getting nervous goes, it changes all the time. Like February was really the last time that I did stand up before this whole quarantine thing happened. I had one of my biggest chunks of material, because that as a comedian, you're always trying to build an hour.
Right.
Because if you have an hour, not only can you chop that up like, hey, can you open for me and do 15 minutes? Okay, I'm going to pick all of my best jokes from that hour.
Right.
and I'm going to do your 15 minutes and open for you. And that's going to open me up to more opportunities later. Or, hey, we need you to do 20 minutes, or we need you to do 30 minutes. If you're doing an hour, you're headlining. So if, as long as you have an hour of material,
you're good.
You're good. And then, but that's the thing. A lot of people will ask me, like, well, how come you don't post comedy videos that often? I'm not trying to give everything away for free. It's like being a magician. I don't want to show you all of my tricks. So, you know, if somebody here in San Diego, if they're paying just to come see me, which is still on the low end right now.
Sure.
If they're paying to come see me, I don't want to have 9 videos out there on YouTube and that's all my,
And that's all your jokes. Right. Right. Exactly.
So,
hey, let me grab my, I got another question to follow it up. Let me grab my phone charger real quick.
Okay. You're good, man. You're good.
All right, we good. All right, so with that, how do you, I'm interested, like, just with everything, the how this whole conversation's turned around, the social media thing, how do you look at that as far as you putting content out? Like you said, people are like, why don't you put out videos of you doing stand-up? Because I guess in their head, they're thinking if you put out videos of you doing stand-up, then that would make people more interested in coming to see you do stand up. But like you said, if I give you all my material, why would you want to come see me do that? Because you can just, you would, you know, I can't give you all of my jokes, you know? So how do you look at that as far as content from a comedian's perspective?
So I'm kind of glad you brought that up. It's ironic because I was supposed to go see him next weekend perform in LA. He was shooting his special. He just got really popular out of nowhere like a year or so ago. His name's Andrew Schultz.
Okay.
So Andrew Schultz, he's been around for years and years and years. He's been around for like 10 years, 10, 15 years, where he was doing like Spring Break with MTV, and he was on a couple of podcasts with Charlemagne the God and things like that.
Yeah.
Never really, you know, blown up to where he is now. And he's been a stand-up comedian the entire time. It was just recently where he went on like Joe Rogan and he explained everything. And now everybody calls it like the Schultz effect, because he didn't go to any of the mainstream like Netflix or anything like that. He started putting out all of his content on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
Blew up from that.
Right. Well,
the question that you just asked, how is he doing that and still running, you know, an hour of material? He's touring while he does this, and he films everywhere that he does. He does almost like a travel vlog, and he puts his stand up in that. He's doing crowd work. So he'll sit there. He's a master of crowd work. That's the one thing that still kind of puts fear in my heart is crowd work, because it's you don't know what somebody could say back to you. I could be like, hey, where are you from? And he'd be like, fuck you. And okay, now I have to turn this around.
Exactly. I have to make this offensive moment funny for the whole room. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And he is a master at crowd work. So
that makes sense.
A lot of what you see people, what they put on social media is stuff that they've either already done for like a major network, or it's crowd work. And he has completely blown up just from putting out crowd work clips on YouTube. He did a special. He dropped it the same day that Chappelle dropped his last special, the Sticks and Stone one that he did in Atlanta, which actually it still to this day bothers me, because I tried so hard to convince my wife, like, hey, Dave Chappelle's going to be in Atlanta this weekend. We were on our way up to Gatlinburg. And I was like, he's going to be in Atlanta this weekend. Like, the tickets are only like $30. Could we please go? And she said, no. And that was when he.
Holy shit.
But he dropped his, he dropped a special on YouTube the same day, and it was called the crowd work special, where he literally just goes out in front of a crowd in like DC. It's only 30 minutes long, but he just does crowd work the whole time. So he drops a special that normally people will work years just getting their material together, just to, okay, this is my best hour right now. And they put that out in the form of a special. He just goes out there and wings it for 30 minutes and gets 2-3 million views. And then by doing that, he's now more serious to the industry. He goes back and says, okay, this is what I want. This is what I, you know, expect from it. And he, you know, makes a deal for a special that he was supposed to film on the 11th in LA, but he's not going to now. So that's what he brought to the table. So,
wow, that's interesting. How do you approach that? So is it the podcast thing? I know a lot of comedians are doing that now.
Yeah, right now, because I can't really work on stand up. I can write. That's really all I can do right now at this point is write. As long as this quarantine is going on, I can sit down and write, and that's all I'm able to do. So I have to get back to the nitty gritty of writing everything down, trying to, you know, okay, how can I make this sentence funnier? I have to start doing that again. But that's why I took an opportunity to start ramping up my podcast again, because I've been doing the podcast for about almost 2 years now. And, you know, it's still on, you know, the very bottom of the floor of getting it to where I want it to be. But that's the thing, you know, if, like you said, it's about being present. If I, you know, get an opportunity to open for somebody, you know, when they introduce me and they do my credits, they'll be like, you know, he's open for Donnell Rawlings, he's open for Dave Chappelle. This is all obviously just, you know, fantasy, but
yeah, hypothetical. Yeah.
And so I can be like, oh, and he also hosts the podcast, the Mac Daddy Seminar, coming to the stage, Taylor Dunn. And I get a video of that along with a little bit of some jokes, and I can post that on social media. That's what I'll do. So,
right.
It happens rarely. I normally just promote with like pictures. So I'll get a picture of me doing a set here or a picture of me doing a set here. And then I'll post that and be like, hey, I'm coming back this upcoming weekend. You know, I'll be opening for this person. Or like I was supposed to do a show on the 4th, a showcase at the Comedy Palace. And it got canceled because of this whole pandemic. But, you know, that's basically how I'm going about. It's all about trying to market yourself.
Oh man,
as a stand-up,
that's the whole, man, with that's half the battle, man. It's like every creative, that's now what you have to figure out is, you know, after you've put all the hard work into making whatever your product is, whether it's an hour comedy set or whether it's a song, you know, on my end or whatever it is, now you have to try to convince people that it's the shit, and not only that, but to take the extra step to click a button, go to your, you know, whatever it is, your website, and, you know, or to your YouTube page or to your SoundCloud or to your Spotify, and, you know, like it, you know, and, you know, that's the part, I guess that's what I was referring to earlier with the psychology and marketing. It's like that's the part that is the other end that I feel like I'm practicing at, you know. It's like, you know, because there's the internet changed the game, and it opened the door for like now everybody can do everything, which is great, but now there's all this competition and you have to fight through all this noise to just even be heard or even be seen, let alone get somebody to become to grow a fan base, you know. So you can, you know, 'cause at the end of the day, we're just trying to eat, you know, we want to do this for the rest of our lives. So that, yeah, that's the most interesting stuff to me, man. I see there's a lot of like that new wave of comedians that I love that are like Instagram comedians, you know, they've built their content from like making funny videos on Instagram or whatever it is. And it's so entertaining. but then you see them still have to like try to convert all of those people to like, hey, I'm going to be in Nashville. I'm going to be in Atlanta. Like, you know what I mean? And that you still see, you can have 100,000 followers on Instagram, but 10 people come to your show, you know? And it's like, how do you, that fascinates me.
Oh yeah. It's an art form that takes such a long time to master. Like the thing about like Dave Chappelle, everybody wants to be the next Dave Chappelle. I feel like it's pretty much across the board right now. You could pretty much ask anybody. He's at a minimum in your top five.
Oh, he's the GOAT. Yeah.
He's my number one.
Same.
Like I can sit there and watch his material and not only laugh my ass off, but I feel like I took something away with it.
Exactly.
I can sit there and I can look at stuff from a different perspective and go, wow, like he's so beyond gifted, and he's basically writing the Bible of how to be a great comedian.
Yep.
I don't see anybody else even in comparison with him. Like he grew up watching Eddie Murphy, but I think he surpassed Eddie Murphy, you know, 10, 15 years ago.
Yeah.
But that was really one of my last questions I wanted to ask you, because we've been at this for about an hour now, and I'm sure you've got stuff to do. Who is your biggest influence as a musician, would you say?
Man, that's a good question, man. As a musician, like I said, I grew up playing gospel music, and so there's this guy, he's still around, he's a producer and a keyboard player, and his name is Aaron Lindsay, and you know, he's a beast. Like he's an absolute monster of a keyboard player and producer, and like most people won't know who he is because it's gospel music, such a small market, it's not popular music. But I remember that being like my first like bit, like I want to be that guy. Influence. And then from there, once I got into like pop music and rap and hip hop, Pharrell. Okay. Pharrell is like, he to me, he just embodied everything that he still does, embodies everything that I want to be, and like all the musical aspects of like being a producer, an artist. He's a fashion icon, like just his sense of style is crazy, and just his approach to life, even, you know, like just the way he's had all the success, but he still remains so humble and giving and caring. And I got to see him play. We played a festival in Napa Valley last year, and he headlined the festival. And we stayed an extra day, and we got to go see the show. And like, so we're walking to go to the Pharrell set, and the promoter of we happened to run into the promoter of the festival, and he's like, "Hey, are you guys headed to see Pharrell?" We're like, yeah. And we were just going to stand in the very front. You know how at festivals they have like the general admission, and then they have the blocked off thing, and there's usually like artists that kind of stand in the front and just kind of hang. We were just going to stand there and hang out or whatever. And we were like, yeah, we're going to see Pharrell. He was like, follow me. So he takes us back to the soundboard where the guy's mixing the sound. It has like the best view. You can hear the best sound. We're like freaking out. It's like, holy shit, like this is cool. And then Big Boy from Outkast and his whole entourage walk up right beside us, and they're standing there right beside us there to see Pharrell too. So I'm watching like my idol on stage. I'm watching one of my favorite rap groups of all, like with one of my favorite rappers from one of my favorite rap groups of all time. He's like standing right next to me. And I'm like, and I just remember watching Pharrell, and I'm like, this is like, that's what I want to do. That's what I want to be. Like those moments in life where you see it all. You're just like, that. I don't even know how to put it in words, but that. that's who I want to be. So, yeah, early on, there was heavy gospel influence, but I feel like once I kind of found my way into what I really feel like I wanted to do, Pharrell is definitely one of my biggest influences. Also, I know he takes a lot of flack, but Kanye was a really, still is a really big creative influence on me. Yeah. Kanye is the reason I got into hip hop. Like, I got into hip hop relatively late, but once I heard some of that Kanye shit, I was like, holy shit, this is like, what the fuck is this? You know, like, just creatively, shit's on another level. So it's guys like that, you know, like the producer artist guys who have, you know, just like changed the sound of modern music and pop music, and like, just so creative, man. So it's guys like that are my influences, man.
Absolutely, man. I'll tell you what, man, everything that we see that you do, I know I'm not alone when I say this, it's very inspiring. And whenever we see it, and we're just like, man, this dude, you're out here living the dream, man.
Thanks, man.
You just doing what you do and knowing how much you enjoy it, it's an inspiration to me, and it's an inspiration to a lot of people. So I really appreciate, you know, you being on here today, and I'm sure a lot of other people will enjoy it as well.
Man, thanks for having me, man. I really enjoyed this, man. I didn't even realize an hour had gone by. But...
Oh, yeah.
So that's it. I hope you guys enjoyed the episode. Once again, thank you, Philip Towns, for sitting down with me and just sitting down, hashing it out, and, you know, catching up, man. It was great seeing you. If you're interested in being on this podcast, I would love to have you. Please reach out to me on Instagram, @TaylorDunn__, or hit me up on my Mac Daddy Seminar Instagram page, or just reach out to me directly if you know me personally. I'd love to have you on. I don't know if these interviews, how long they're going to last. You know, I'm just kind of rolling with the punches here, but all in all, I'm still going to do the podcast just me as normal for those of you, the pimps and pimpettes that love this shit every single week. You know, I appreciate y'all. Once again, thank you, Philip Towns, for sitting down with me. If you want to look him up or listen to some of his music, look him up on YouTube. Listen to Anderson East. He has so much content out there, guys, and his Instagram handle is Phil the Chandler. I got that written down somewhere. Yeah, PhilTheChandler. Look him up, y'all. He is one of a kind, and I'm glad to call him a friend. As always, I appreciate you guys listening to the Mac Daddy Seminar. Go ahead and click subscribe if you want more videos like this. I'm going to be uploading them pretty much on a weekly to bi-weekly basis at this point. So if you like this type of stuff, click that subscribe button, and I will see you guys next week. Y'all take care.